first you invited us to look at the first site, which was a, and that gave us inspiration because it was already a site where it was like a village, a community, with as well houses on top of roofs.
It's always there as a village, a secret village somewhere there.
At the same time, I see bigger buildings coming up that don't have a very individual expression. I know the process, that gradually the city will turn in higher densities because of the value of the ground. That in the same moment, people that used to live underground with having a townhouse, they go out of the city. So I was wondering, can't we not get those people back? Can't we not say, instead of, say, reducing that tapestry of villages, make more out of it? And can we then not densify that by stacking houses, villas, private houses on top of each other, so that suddenly that roof light, that becomes actually everywhere, and that you start to have a kind of environment which is so attractive, namely where you meet people, where you have your own identity, and where you can grow your kids, and where mongers and sellers can go through in a vertical way. And that therefore, say the anonymity of the public of the buildings that suddenly become less anonymous, and that in that way you can have a city again where many type of people can live. Behind it. Now we exist now for, what is it, 12, 14 years, and over time we have developed like a tool or a method to that even bigger issues in architecture and urbanism can become very visual and can be clarified through architecture. So what we try to do within our buildings is to give that bigger agenda, to give that directly a translation. Because most of the architecture in the world are about like intuition, or they're about beauty, but or are they really about what the society wants to be done these days? I think that's what we try to do, and that any building becomes almost like an object that says something more than only itself. It wants to say something about the city, it wants to say something about the urbanism in general, it wants to say something about where we are going to with our cities or with our architecture.
Very attractive element in our office that we have marked so many people from different places. I think we benefit from their cultural knowledges about the countries where we work.
Later, it became for us also an instrument to bridge the gap between our culture and the culture of the countries we are working in. So we experience, it can be of great advantage that we have in a team that works in another country, somebody who understands the culture, who understands the language. So in that way we are not just making alien proposals that land in different countries, but we also can really have a communication. From the beginning, we were interested in making new topologies and new ways of living for a population, especially in Holland, that grew ever denser. So we immediately started to layer a lot of different functions, try to optimize the use of land, because we thought this is needed in Holland. The population was growing and wanted more and bigger houses. And we started to use up so many land that we thought we need a counterbalance to that. We have to think about how to combine functions more, how to bring them back to the inner cities, and how to make more effective use of land. And you have to make very convincing new types of living then, because the Dutch are used to a lot of space. They like houses with gardens, and they are not so many who are willing to live in apartment buildings or in high rises. It's not so common.
Now this is, I think, an interesting link to the Village Maker project, which also deals with living in a kind of different way in the city. And this combination of having the village style living in the big metropolis, I think it can be a very attractive way, that you still combine the community feeling of a small village with the facilities of the big city. And ideally, I think, yeah, this would be applicable in many countries in different ways.
Architecture is as well about responding to directions and to think about it. So that's what we want to add, the why factor, towards architecture and urbanism. And that we want to do that in a very quick way. So what we imagine is a kind of almost like a factory, a production line of questions. And that shows as well that we want to respond quick. We want as well to immediately to reveal to that the next step. Because if you have solved something, then the next issue comes always abroad. So that's why it's a factory, and the factory is therefore designed as a kind of enormous amount of tables. And sometimes we work in lines, like for the vertical village, and as a sequence of thinking. And the Y factory, because how do you start, Tenant? So what we propose is first to work on future cities. So we have a future city program, is it called, where we can see that, say, this reasoning can be exercised. And the future city is also a method to understand the issue about what's next. Everyone asks always, what's next? It's about curiosity. It's about you want to learn, you want to know what the nextness is. So we design the future city. That's what we do. But of course, you cannot make the future city. There are many futures in that way. So we do it in a very wide way, this research on the future city.
The vertical village concept was questioning the now kind of typology that is dominating the city. As you could easily see all over the world, we didn't have the alternative except these high-rising towers. We made three parts. First, understanding what kind of phenomenon the city have. And what kind of possibility we could approach is the second part. The third part is exploring the future.
Well, I'm working with three separate groups. And one is the editorial group. And they are doing interviews with different people. For example, they interviewed people on the street to find out what do people want in terms of their living conditions in Taipei. We interviewed a developer to understand what does developer need. We want to interview also a planner in terms of the urban planning. And we also interviewed a sociologist to understand, for example, what is the difference between a village and urban, and what are the good parts of both and what are the negative parts of both. group. Then another one is the lifestyle group. They are collecting definitions of village, urban village and urban, trying to define the qualities that make an urban village, that are the positive qualities that we should bring to the design. So they are basically defining the design parameters for the rest of the group. Third one, called urban diversity, and they are collecting different villa types globally to understand what kind of modules, what kind of villas and houses could we use in this building, because we want to bring as much diversity in it as possible. So we're looking globally, not just Taiwan.
This sort of stair, and we combine it with a biogas, and we combine it with...
People start taking you serious because they see you're drawing some details, some sections, some part of it, and they say, wow, they really want to do that. So that was important for that group. We first structured it to get a grip of the whole village and how to make it. We first said that we will look separately into the construction, the structure, into access. How do I get up? What if in a village I have streets, in a vertical village, it's something vertical. I cannot just make a street. I have to make think of stairs, elevators, ramps, whatever. Looking into how you can make zones, zoning in a vertical sense, looking into resources, looking into all kind of different aspects to first only explore a vertical village based on one aspect.
那研究的内容不只是台湾，而是我们希望去看到。 跟全球其他国家的比较，然后再去看到台湾自己的现象，什么样子的生活形态是我们要谈论到的都市村落，然后去定义什么是都市，什么是村落，那什么样子，在这样生活形态的背后的那个价值是什么？我觉得从台湾的角度出发，一定有它的好处，因为我们并不是说不懂要怎么盖高楼或是什么的，而是。
借由从台湾的角度怎么去看，所以它是垂直村落，而不是垂直的城市，那意义就会差很多。对，我自己对于垂直村落的看法，我觉得是一个一个想象空间很大的未来，因为毕竟像尤其在亚洲或中国看到那样子新的城市的开发，或是那种 gate community 那样的现象，对我来说是一个很可怕的。 未来城市空间是不人性的，然后大家都是被封闭在同样的一个社区，然后你的安全可能是在那个警卫室之后就被控制，可是其实是一个非常封闭的一种生活空间。所谓的垂直化，可能会有人会问说，那现在高楼不都垂直化吗？有时候二三十楼、三四十楼它都是垂直的，可是
vertical village 不一样的是，它强调的是。我觉得它强调的不是 vertical， 而是 village。 现在住宅早就 vertical 了，可是它没有一个 village， 也就是一个村落的一个形态，它没有一个互相互动 community 的关系。那如果当它有那样子的关系，就等于是把过去我们所熟悉的一些生活，长民的一些村落的生活状态，把它拉到高层化。那我觉得 village 的那个互动才是真正珍贵的地方。那所以，至少我觉得在亚洲密度这么高的地方。 人口其实也是越来越多，那垂直化绝对是其中一个可能性。Vertical
Village 那时候还有一个想到是说，除了实质层面之外，还有另外一个想法是，它到底对于我们现在的城市，它到底改变了什么？因为我们在 Vertical Village 一直强调人的机能的 mixed use， 然后跟人的交流。那我觉得它不一定是真的可以被达成，但是它或许是可以反讽我们现在的人。 同样是 Vertical Village， 那可能或许现在的 公寓大厦它就是 Vertical Village，
但是它的人之间到底有没有交流？因为像现在可能集合住宅、豪宅的东西，他们几乎都是要求他们动线只有他一个人使用的，他不想要跟别人一起共享。然后所以村落这件事情它慢慢变不见了，对。可是我觉得人还是，我觉得人是群居的动物，所以他一定会试着跟其他人做交流、做连接，所以。 村落这件事情等于是我们提供他一个选择，他可以开始去创造他想要的一个生活方式。我觉得那个是有可能发生的。
对我来说，在台湾比较不太可能出现，比较因为我的想法啦，可能我的那个垂直村落的这种想法有一点共产主义，就是他不。
它虽然是每一户人家可以有自己一些变动性，它也可以有各自的独创性，然后也可以垂直，可是某种程度上它需要一个政府或者是一个比较强力量比较大的一个单位去帮助你先把这个架构完成，才能慢慢去发展。
我们未来的趋势就是一直会往高楼发展嘛。第一个情形就是可能我们面临的是海平面的上升，这是消极面来讲。若以积极面来讲，就是垂直村落它是一个能够自己供应自己能源的系统，也许我们可以把那个稻米做一个垂，就是稻田做一个垂直化的系统，植物公园做一个垂直化的系统，或者是草药做一个垂直化的培养的地区，集中在每一个点，然后使得在都市里面也有新的自然元素植入进去，不会说我们一定得要到自然或山地里面才能够找到这些东西。
以人的习惯来切入的话，我会觉得说人到达一定高度的时候，他会失去了对地面的依赖性，所以到底他们，所以他们才不会想要到更高的地方去，因为他们毕竟对这块土地还是有一定的依赖感，所以他们到某定楼层某个楼层的时候，他们就会考虑到那水要怎么办，那么食物要怎么办，或者是空气之类的其他元素，很多其他因素会加进来，就建筑不再只是一个空间，而是它必须满足其他条件才会成立。
我刚刚说50-50，原因是因为一半是我的认知上，以亚洲人认知上它是错，但是另外50%我赞成，原因是因为它可以挑战这件事情。这件事情相对因为挑战的关系，它如果真的被这样垂直化出来的时候，相对的是有可能被实现，而且它可以把不一样的生活 lifestyle 带进来，那才是最重要的。我觉得要探讨是 lifestyle， 不是讨论那个缝或那个形，而是怎么样重新结合人们失去的东西，把它整个再 compose 在一起，堆叠出来。因为我不相信是因为土地面积变小，绝对不是这个 issue， 而是一个新形态 lifestyle 被 represent 出来。所以我觉得对我来说，垂直城市其实是一个新形态的新的生活形态，它跟传统跟现今的生活跟传统生活其实在重新做结合，所以我一直在谈的 revolution， 这东西是一种进化的东西。
If I look at the Asian city, what is quite common is that it was the modernism was not coming from the ground of Asian country or Asian spirit. Lot of knowledge or technology was implemented from Western.And because of that, there is a disconnection between the history or traditional culture. And we didn't have time or understand that culture very much. It was just overlapped. So this time, as we have been experiencing this kind of condition, it would be very interesting to re-bring the historical value and also the natural value back to the urban condition.
From the interviews, I think the most interesting part was talking to the people on the street, so the potential customer that we are trying to design for. Many of them were very, very much interested in bringing back the traditional lifestyle. The half of the people we spoke with would like to see, in one way or another, the traditional layout of a Taiwanese house implemented in a city. Or they were completely willing to leave the city and go outside and live in a village if that were possible.So there already you can see that there is a need to do something different.
Now we concentrate on developing these different concepts and say for each of the concepts that this could be a base for one vertical village. Because we don't believe that there's one ideal way of doing it, as there is not one ideal village, there's a lot of different villages on the world. So we try to bring in this variety by developing very different approaches now with the students.We try to be very utopian and visionary, but at the same time, it's very necessary to have a link to the possible and to the practical.
So there we find out, okay, let's try to make this kind of community on that spot instead of a big block.
initially modest as such. We use the same type of houses and to express only on this combination, on the fact that you make an individual house. When it moved to the other side, which is where we have to compete with the bigger blocks, then say we developed it. We took as well more parameters into account. We increased the individual liberty, and therefore you get more forms, more shapes, more colors, more materials than that was as seen before. So already the project has an evolution, and that's actually the topic.
We have five groups of students, and we aim to produce five dreams of what the vertical village could become. In each case, each dream was sort of developed, evolved from a certain parameter, whether that would be the beauty and the richness of individual garden, whether there would be a possibility to customize your own climate, whether there would be the possibility to sort of introduce a new financing system.
We focused on the typical plot in the village, and especially on the farming plot. Our conclusion was that it was one of the most important qualities was the flexibility. You're able to change your buildings or gardens whenever you like. And then we wanted to transform this two-dimensional plot into a more denser three-dimensional way to be able to connect them in a vertical way. So we are not creating houses, we are creating plots which inhabit as well a garden as a house. We try to make this garden dominant, so these rooms are all covered in the greenery of the plot. In that way we try to create this feeling of the village.
We plan to have, every now and then we plan to have open public space where if this gradually grows, then perhaps few levels there this kind of space would appear, which could be used by the inhabitants. We try to achieve these microclimates in an unusual way, not using mechanical devices, not using, let's say, standard means to do that. Perhaps we won't be that efficient, but the advantage is that we really use mostly natural elements, plants, trees, grass lawns, ivy over here, so that's the principle.
In our vertical village, everything is based on the smallest grain, which is furniture in this case. So people will assemble their village by assembling and putting furniture together, and this tactic, the whole thing will grow.
The idea is that it's not pre-developed like a huge high-rise, but it's always based on the actual financial moment of the people. If their family is growing, then they can attach a house in a new room in real time. So for a newborn child, so it reacts faster and more precise on the needs of the people.
There's a lot of cultural diversity in the model, and you can see like mechanisms which are also exist in the normal city. So it's like a micro city actually, maybe.
Because somewhat after this financial crisis, it became very clear when the housing boom is over that actually the offer, the supply and the quality of the product which is on the real estate market is very limited. We, more or less most of the population, lives in standard buildings, in mass-produced housing blocks. So in a way, this now is a very good moment to look into different possibilities and just ask ourselves whether, you know, our dwellings in the 21st century could be more diversified, whether there is more space for individual expression, what are the possibilities of these individual expressions be together, live together in one unity, in one building, in one neighborhood, and in one city.
The Village Maker Evolutionary Vertical Urbanism is a masterclass stage here at the Berlach Institute in collaboration with Y-Factory and Winnie Maas from Technical University in Delft. And the masterclass was investigating with 65 young architects from all over the world the way in which vertical village, which is of course metaphor of the village, but basically vertical habitation could take place all over the world. Many very particular parameters has been put in front of the students in order to deal with them, the parameters of accessibility, of ecological standard of such villages, of the possibility of creation of community, or the ways in which certain individuality could be enforced.
Our parameter is energy, but we connected this one parameter with some others, like structure and climate, economy. And now we add this third world, which is more or less looking like a flower because our color is pink, but it is a water collector. And inside, you can see it from that angle, but inside there is a little pond or lake, how you would describe, where people can swim. So it's adding another kind of program, again, on top of existing housing layers and shops, commercial, everything is going on. So this is our workshop, more or less. It's a dense situation, a really small plot. You have to imagine this in the city.
Yeah, we have to represent the community. And we try to do in the first model, try to combine three different spaces, the really private, the really public, and the really collective. In this case, we try to create in the ground floor the really public space with different functions like cafe or bibliothèque, or really public for everybody.
It is important to understand what was before.
Yeah.
So just this white structure.
Yeah.
That had this empty platform,
yeah.
Elevated empty platform.
Yeah.
And we considered this platform and the ground floor as the two main access points to the dwellings.
Yeah.
So for the accessibility point of view, we considered all the dwellings have to be accessible either from the ground floor or the platform,
yeah.
Or the upper part platform, so you can access all these units.
Yeah.
The idea of verticalizing, the idea of a community, is maybe a response that we need. It's maybe not ideal, but it's maybe a response that will happen anyhow. People are much more tied to the ground than we think, at least in Europe. No? In Europe, the skyscraper has been a disaster. All the social blocks, I mean, for instance, now in Antwerp, they will tear down modernist blocks because they don't work. So it is still the question if humanity can adapt to verticality. I think the exercise should be to horizontalize verticality. That you have the feeling on every layer that there is a very strong feeling of horizontality, of normality, of squares, piazzas, meaningful places like a cafe, a temple, a sauna. That you don't have this idea of the neutral block. And I think here the exercise could here be quite fertile. That's what I insisted on, that you really go for what I call heterotopias, namely for functions that are communal. The temple, the cafe, the museum, the library, the sports field, the gym. It's there that the community, think of any village, the village is not the dwellings.
I believe in an experiment, absolutely. But if we look to the models which has been achieved, of course they are not buildable. One should not look to these models as already kind of manifestations of the next forms of habitation. They really look them as models which are showing some sort of criteria or the arguments upon which those villages could be constructed. Of course, it's a huge question. Who will basically in the future be the major party or the key stakeholder, that's the word, which will establish such villages? Are we talking about governments? Are we talking about private corporations? Are we talking of new alliances of different individuals? That's a very interesting question.
I'm very intrigued what this exhibition will lead to. It sets a discussion. I think it's an observation on a situation which is there. Itself is already a village, and so dealing with a small space, how can we survive? The first chapter here is just driving through many cities in this region. We are in a very Asian situation. And why? Because endlessly I see similar towers appearing. They don't have any difference seemingly. Many regional cities, and what happens on these dots and on this process. So in two episodes we notate how much, say, villages, urban villages were there, hutongs, kampungs, whatever you call them in any place, and how much of new, say, dense areas have been constructed. There's something happening in Taipei. So we filmed a series of families, and we discussed with them what they want. We followed them on their tour to find the proper place. They want to have a house close to the city, and they want to have a space where the kid can grow, but they can't find it. It was shocking to see this, that they make a kind of outspoken wish for a certain kind of environment, and that they cannot find it.
If they can accept new ideas, or this idea 被很多人接受的话，在这个社会接受的话，它就会有新的一个具体的形式会呈现出来。对，因为像现在我们所看到很多的事物或建筑物的形式，都是因为我们被很多人大部分所接受，他的想法是这样子，所以它呈现出是这样的形式。对，所以我觉得新的观念跟新的想法会产生新的形式跟样貌。
And it looks like a village. And if you go in, you see what community aspects people like. We investigated in this case what are the important aspects of, say, a community. So on the ground you find the words that are connected with living in a community. So maybe we give definitions to the government, to initiative takers, to make criteria. What should we make? Give this list to the architect and make it like that, and maybe it works out.
从建筑物上面来讲，它是一个象征性，就是说它是一个抽象体。这个抽象体告诉我，我们需要这种，我们需要穿透，我们需要人的公共空间，我们也需要有很独立不同的样子。所以我觉得他在这个地方其实看到了一种机会，就是在时代的发展里面，随着社会文化的变化里面，我们人其实不断在问自己，我们到底要活在一个什么样生活状态里。This
is a tunnel. And the tunnel is, of course, because we are not new. This has been done in the past. More architects have asked us to do. So what we try to reveal in this one is simply a Google search, how many vertical villages do exist. And it was shocking to see how much already in Google exists on that matter.
他想做的其实并不是在挑战一种建筑技术的可能。我觉得他在做的一件事情是 把人的关系重新去修复，是这件事情；把人的互动去把它连接起来，是这件事情。
It was an attempt with people to phone different houses. We want to make a pile of 100,000 houses. Because that's the program, what you're going to do the coming 10 years in Taipei. So these are 100,000 different houses. Ultimately, of course, this pile we have to spread over Taipei. And we worked on 9 different kampungs. We tried to reveal how it was and what kind of specialism these kampungs have. So we imagined with students there 10 steps to gradually improve the kampungs. And there are many of them. Everyone with that specialism, step by step, small piece by small piece, blending up a possible, say, vertical, intense, and a new village and economy. On this side you see different starting villages. And these owners, they started to make a village that optimizes one task, each another task. I mean, what happens if the energy group reacts on the structure? And I think these reactions are important in the future of our urbanism, in order to allow for reactions.
就说他看垂村落，我也很质疑说他究竟有没有被建造的可能性。可是刚刚看那个短片里面又说，就是可能这个垂直村落这个议题，它重要的不是说它能不能被建出来，而是说去激发人去思考说，哎，还有这样一种可能性，就是未来的居住方式可能会是不一样的一种方式。那可能就是怎么说呢？就是告诉我们。 就是引发我们去用一种不一样的思考方式去想，就是居住是一个怎么样的事情，然后我们可以怎么样就是亲自去参与它。
5 possible vertical villages, and actually they are all extremely beautiful. They're presented like supermodels, and you can have an overview from one perspective. They concentrate on different aspects. So after the matrix. This is the house maker under development. And like when you go to IKEA and try to get your kitchen, maybe in this case you can make your own house. Design it. If you want to make a heart-like house or a cupola, whatever you want, it orchestrates it and it says how much it costs. But how to get that? Maybe that's why we need this classroom in order to activate that hidden knowledge that is somewhere there. The dream is when it's in your computer, it will be sent here to make a drawing like this. So you can take it home. You have your house with you and you give it to your architect. So we want to build up a collection of houses. This is what the new kind of, say, selling office can be. So we are looking forward to ideas that we don't have and that you will bring across in this classroom. Your town hall at the moment is, like in Europe, is awful. You have no clue what they are planning. I think in the future, planning should be just through these devices. It's a software that helps you, or you, when you have designed your house, to position it somewhere. Somewhere in this new box. The software calculates for you what is the best sun angle. How many neighbors do you want to have around? And where? And how much it costs? It adds the infrastructure to your house. It hopes to give an alternative. Of those blocks at a moment that it will see. And I hope that therefore it can give any interpretation of how individuality and density can be combined.
I think this concept is very good.
好，我想要什么，然后我自己决定，像刚才那个软体，我要窗户，我要什么都可以我自己选，要光线啊什么都可以自己选。可是刚才他的意思是说，你把它这个设想好，那你跟你的邻居之间，我要上我要下我要光线，那到时候要组成一个整个一个大的聚落的话，那是会造成很多的一些什么纷争啊，我要这样你要那样啊，我们就在两个人在笑说，这样盖得起来吗？尤其在台湾来讲，你盖得起来吗？对不对？都会有一种
不是要去把所有的意见协调下来、
哦、
这个过程大概难度蛮高的。
没有，因为真的觉得这很不简单，因为尤其是在像我们这种环境里面，要看到这种就是蛮天真但是又很有想法的事情被实现，是一件蛮辛苦的事情。
城市村落不可能只是最后一个结果，我们其实要看到说你怎么去做出这样子最后的一个想象，那个过程中怎么去操作一步一步的，所以可能很多人说我们是一个比较理性的操作手法，可是其实那个理性的背后是有不同的依据，那些依据只是也是像其他建筑师可能他们会比较考虑不同的因素，可是这样子的因素才能够导出最后一个设计结果。
I think the challenge is to build it and not make it a very exclusive high-end VIP project. I think the real challenge lies in developing a concept, developing a vertical village which can grow, which really is not only, whichdoes not only contain the image of a village, but really has a sense of community in it, and which is accessible not only to very rich people, but which is more accessible, which can compete with more average and standard apartments.
I think it's not impossible. If you really consider that you can like,repeat the experience of the horizontal village in layers of complexities, I think it's a challenge. Of course, we know from the experience of the 20th century that it's not easy.
In a belief that we should build something like this, and what we would build would really be, till a certain extent, emancipatory to the individuals to live in such conditions.
We definitely we hope that we could contribute to the debate sufficiently, and we can make some problems and issues discussable by our projects and by our publications. So we would look forward to have a certain audience for what we do, and to have a lot of feedback and develop our project further.
Image was very important. I was looking at the science, the logic of the logic, to explore the tomorrowness, but rather than that,It was very important to focus on the image, because image is first, and by image you could make the logic out of that. So I'm willing to fantasize as much as possible to enlarge the scope of tomorrowness.
We actually hope that the people from this exhibition can understand that the possibility of a better life is not only from比如说室内的空间美学或建筑的这个设计风格当中去得到，其实更重要的城市的形态跟构造也是影响美好生活相当重要的一环，那我们希望民众可以透过这个展览可以理解到这些都是可以去思考跟必须被充分的讨论，而民众他有这样的一个责任也有这样的一个权利可以参与在这样的一个讨论当中。
It's also an open, say, question mark to everybody, how he or she wants to live. And it'll be very curious about it. How people, because people are not trained normally to they accept what you can get. So how can we create a culture where you can get what you want, or where you express what you want, and when you try to realize that? And that's what this exhibition is about.Indeed, it ends, of course, with that big question mark. As we started, what's next? It ends with what's next.